nothing posh, nothing the usual work to scratch. This is from school, my high society. Here in the slums of San Michelle, we live on crumbs or a bun for piety. Tap on the teeth, but what the hell? Think you're poor, think you're free. Follow me, follow me! The time we killed the king, we tried to change the world too fast. Now we have got another king, he is no better than the last. This is the land that fought for liberty. Now when we fight for bread. Here is the thing about equality, everyone's equal when they're dead. Take your place, take your chance. Vive la France! Vive la France!
Vive la France!
Something's gotta happen now.
Where are the leaders of the land?
Where is the king who runs this show?
There's only one man, General Lamarck, speaks for the people here below. Lamarck is ill and fading fast. Won't last a week out, so they say.
With all the anger in the land, how long before the judgment day?
Before we cut the fat ones down to size.
Hand to the king! Liberty for all!
Before the barricades arise!
Welcome once again to the Radical Imagination. I'm your host, Jim Vrettos. I'm a sociologist and criminologist who's taught at John Jay College of Criminal Justice and Yeshiva University here in New York. Richard Cloward was an American sociologist, criminologist, community organizer, and social activist. He's widely recognized as one of the most influential figures on the United States and international left in the 20th century. The son of a radical Baptist minister father and a mother who was an artist and early women's rights activist, Dick did his graduate work at Columbia University, held a PhD in sociology at Columbia, and was a former student of Robert Merton, who is widely considered one of the founding fathers of modern sociology and a major contributor to the field of criminology and the sociology of violence and the sociology of deviance. Dick was a professor for over 47 years at Columbia University School of Social Work from 1954 until his untimely death in 2001. This is our first of three shows on his life and work, and today's show will be dedicated to his early work as a sociologist and a criminologist. In later shows, we'll be discussing his social and political activism with his frequent collaborator and wife, Frances Fox Piven, and their efforts to influence social policy through groundbreaking grassroots organizing and lobbying among the poor for a guaranteed annual income through the National Welfare Rights Organization and through HumanServe, which established the National Voter Registration Act of 1993, popularly known as the Motor Voter Bill. Dick, however, first achieved national recognition as a sociologist and criminologist with Delinquency and Opportunity, written in 1960 with Lloyd Olin, and that's where we want to start. Many of his later books in social activism were rooted in this work, where he grapples with the classical foundational ideas and theories in the field. And in a sense, Dick's seminal work spans close to 100 years in the history of American criminology, the sociology of deviance, urban sociology, and political theory. Cloward and Olin argue that delinquency among very poor inner city youth was a rational reaction to limited economic opportunities. And they did what social scientists don't very often do. They actually invented social programs that became social policy and put opportunity theory into practice on the Lower East Side of Manhattan with the creation of a project called Mobilization for Youth to help youth gang members on their own terms. MFY quickly became the programmatic model for the federal war on poverty, pioneered community action programs, and the anti-poverty legal services. Our guest today on The Radical Imagination is one of the most prolific and highly acclaimed sociologists and criminologists of our time. He also had the great good fortune and opportunity to do his dissertation under Dick. Francis Cullen is the Distinguished Research Professor Emeritus and Senior Research Associate, the School of Criminal Justice at the University of Cincinnati. He's published over 400 works, has over 55,000 citations in the areas of crime and deviance theory, corrections, public opinion, white-collar crime, and sexual victimization, and has been past president of both the American Society of Criminology and the Academy of Criminal Justice Sciences. To do your graduate work under Dick Cloward was not only to spend a number of years learning from a master craftsman, but learning from a human being deeply committed and morally centered in his scholarship and activism. You learn that true scholarship and an activist life of moral integrity can in fact coexist and indeed flourish, leading to a more complete understanding of the complexity of human behavior. When I decided to do a series of shows about Dick's work and life, one of the very first people I thought of having on was Frank. I share that profound experience with Frank of having done my grad work with Dick too. Frank is carrying on the mentor experience he learned with his own lucky grad students today. The Radical Imagination tries to carry it on through this week, this show every week. Welcome, Frank. It's so great to have you here. Again, I look forward to meeting you for the first time. I feel as if we are, in fact, soulmates, intellectual soulmates, and so on. And thank you so much for accepting the offer to be on the show.
I am really delighted to be here. I feel the same way about you. There were not many people that Dick mentored in criminology, and I feel like we're two of the people of the same generation. I think we're probably the same age. I'm 69, and it was a great experience to be with Dick now many years ago. And although I got my degree in 1979, so it's been four decades since I worked with him a lot. The memories still remain vivid, and his impact on my life has been enduring. So I'm delighted to have a chance to think about the past and to relive some of those memories with you and your audience.
Same here, truly. So how did it all begin? Did you take a course from him? You went to Bridgewater State College, correct, in Cincinnati? I'm sorry, in Connecticut. As undergraduate?
No, but yeah. It was, I started at Bridgewater State College, which is actually, it's a small college in Massachusetts. There was another Bridgewater in Bridgeport, Connecticut. Everyone has always said that to me, so I'm glad to see that. It was unlikely that going to what was then mostly a state teacher's college would lead me into academia. It was mostly a working class college. But I had an opportunity to go to Columbia University, and I grew up in Boston, went to Boston English High School, which was an integrated high school at that time. Boston was in the grips of a whole controversy over busing, violence, and I went to Teachers College at Columbia University to study urban education, race, busing, violence, and things of that sort. But what happens, I think, in life is that there is contingencies, very unexpected contingencies, and one of those was Richard Cloward. I knew that he was teaching a class in the School of Social Work, and I had an elective. So I decided to walk down Broadway to the School of Social Work, and I sat in his class with all the social workers. I didn't say anything the whole term because I felt a little bit of a foreigner invading their territory. And I wrote a paper for him called On Labeling Theory and Schools. And I got back from him the comments. All it said in the paper was A plus, good job. I've never gotten an A plus before. So I thought, this is my guy. So I went ahead and then asked him for a readings course in criminology. Right. And he agreed to do so.
What was the course you were sitting in on at the social work school? What was that
called? He had a course called Deviance in the Social Structure. I was expecting it to be all about his delinquency work. But by that time, he pretty much moved out of criminology. And he had just written Regulating the Poor with Francis Fox Piven. And what the course was about was how ideas about social welfare sometimes can be used for the good, but oftentimes were used to mask coercive and treatments or policies that were meant to control deviant and poor people. So the class was really about how we use ideas to manage the poor, regulate the poor and other deviant populations. And so I was expecting a course on delinquency and opportunity, right. but his earlier work, but literally he had moved on from that. And so when I asked him for a readings course, it was to go back and revisit his earlier work on criminology. And I was in his course and he gave me some stuff to read. And I came back the next week, he gave me some more stuff to read. I came back like 3 days later. And he said, you want to write your dissertation under me? And I said, let me think about it. Yes, of course I want to write my dissertation under you. And at that moment I became a criminologist. Like it was completely a contingency, a turning point in my career, completely unexpected, but one that has benefited from for the next 4 decades.
Obviously, yeah. So those readings gave you the foundation and understanding of criminology, theories of crime, in the criminology, the sociology of deviance.
What he was trying to do for me was to recreate the process by which he came to his distinctive ideas in criminology. So he had me go back and read everything he read in his work, early work. And just to do it very simply for your audience,
sure.
He built off the work of Robert Merton, as you've noted, one of the most influential sociologists of the 20th century. A lot of people don't know this, but Robert Merton grew up in South Philadelphia in a slum. His birth name was Meyer Skolnick. It was not Robert Merton. He changed his name when he decided.
Yeah, changed his name. Sorry.
Yes, bro. Jewish background. And so he eventually changed his name to Robert Merton and went off to Harvard and then eventually to Columbia University. But I think his experience of growing up in a slum area and rising to the top of his profession influenced the way in which he thought about America. Because what he noted was there was a universal goal that everybody in America is taught to seek success and riches and are told that anybody can be successful. But he knew from his experiences in South Philadelphia that wasn't true, that opportunities were differentially allocated by where you happen to be born. He was the exception, not the rule. And his theory of crime and deviance, simply put, was that if you teach everybody to want to be successful, but then a large source of segment of the population cannot attain that goal, they are going to experience frustration or strain and have a problem they have to adjust to, one of which is to use crime and deviant means to get successful.
The innovative adaptation, well, as he would put it.
Yes, what he called the innovative adaptation, that you use deviant or criminal means to attain the goal of success. Right. There were other adaptations you could make. Criminologists tend to focus on that. What Richard's insight was about was that there were actually two kinds of opportunity. The opportunity to get the goal of success. But then he said, you can't just go out and become any kind of criminal you want to be. For example, you can't just go out and join a gang. In my neighborhood, for example, middle-class neighborhood in Cincinnati, I've often joked that if kids wanted to join a gang, the parents would have to organize gang day, like tennis on Monday, you know, music on Tuesday, and gang day on Wednesday. We'd get all the kids together, right? Because you just can't go out and there's no gangs to join here. There's no traditions. There's not enough kids that would engage in that behavior. So what Richard was pointing to is that in order to become a gang member, you had to grow up in a certain kind of neighborhood. Otherwise, you might be an individual delinquent. You might turn to drugs, or you might even commit suicide or do something else. But what Merton had not thought about was there were two opportunity structures. One that allowed you to get the goal of success, and another one that determined whether you could become a criminal, and if so, which one. And it was that was the aspect of his work that I built off of, and that he had felt that he had articulated in Delinquency and Opportunity, a book with Lloyd Olin, but then had left behind as he went into, as you mentioned, Mobilization for Youth and a lot of the other political activity that captured his life during the 1960s.
Now, in your readings also, including obviously your readings with Merton, you're introduced to the classical strain theorists and primarily Durkheim and the influence that Durkheim had on Merton and then later on Cloward, right? So help us a little understand that connection. Durkheim's work on suicide is 1897. So, and Merton's work, Social Structured Enemy, is 1939. So, and again, Cloward's work, 1960. So we're talking almost over 60 years here of a evolution of an idea.
Yeah, I think I'd also add in Albert Cohen's work in 1955, who was another student of Merton, who wrote a similar book called Delinquent Boys. And I think there was a reaction here among Merton, Cloward, and Cohen to some of the more individualistic theories that had existed prior to this, oftentimes with racist overtones, blaming people's criminality on their biology or on their having been born into certain so-called inferior groups. There was a reaction against that, saying, no, crime is not a product of individual defects so much as it is a product of the way in which we organize our society. And that was one of the key insights of Emile Durkheim's work. He took the most personal of choices, suicide, and he said, we can explain rates of suicide by looking at the conditions in society. In particular, if we have people who are at a certain level and they lose everything, that can cause them to become very stressful and then turn to suicide. And so what the project of Merton following up from Durkheim and of Cloward and Cohen and people like that was to show how deviance and crime was not an individual defect, but rooted into the very fabric of American society. If you have a society that teaches everyone to seek success and then you systematically block access to that, there are going to be consequences. People are going to have frustration, strain, right? And if you're under strain, you can live with it, but some people can't. And some people will make adaptations to that in a way which will lead them either into individual pathologies like drug use or suicide, or potentially into crime and also into gang delinquency. If there are enough people located in a particular neighborhood who are suffering the same kinds of deprivation, goal blockage, and marginalization, they're going to be drawn together, Cloward would say, and Cohen would say, and make a collective response to this situation, not an individualistic one. But I think today, as we look back, we're really revisiting some of those core insights. And that is that if you don't have a society that's socially just, if you don't ensure that the least among us have the opportunity to share in the pleasures of society, there's going to be consequences of that. People are going to react in ways that are either self-destructive, other destructive, or both. And so I think the ideas of Merton and Cloward are as poignant and pertinent today as they were when they were written some, 60, 80 years ago.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So to start with, again, the focus becomes not the individual, but the social structure and culture that they are living under and through. Now, this resonated so much, as you know, with at that time with Cloward's work, which got turned into, because politically it was a time where politicians were more open to it, mobilization for youth. So the Kennedy administration looked at this idea and theory and really went with it and saw this as part of a way to reform and structure American society somewhat differently. And that, again, fell into their own political goals of opening up America to new ideas and opportunities. So Cloward, in a sense, his work was, it was very fortunate that it was also written at a time when it was politically very advantageous atmosphere for him too.
No, I think that's a very important insight. He one time told me that when he and Lloyd Olin wrote their book, Delinquency and Opportunity, that the Free Press wanted them to change the title to something else, of delinquent gangs or something like that. And they refused to do so. And he said, the title of the book is one of the key reasons why the Kennedy administration was drawn to it so yeah. quickly, because they were, you know, again, proselytizing the view that we're going to have a new society, provide equal opportunity, particularly for the poor. And when they looked around, as you had mentioned before, that book was the Bible, so to speak, to provide an explanation for why delinquency occurred and then a roadmap for what to do about it. If denial of opportunity was a core source of delinquent behavior, then the idea of opening up the social structure to opportunity and to have delinquency programs like mobilization for youth that would provide opportunity became the obvious solution. And I think that was the linkage for Richard into his activism, because the whole notion of how to help poor people and how to provide opportunity for poor people became really his life's work after that. And so his work on criminology sort of had the effect of providing an avenue for him into or to reinforce his work on looking at the status of poor people in American society, what could be done to provide that opportunity, and ultimately what could be done politically to advance their causes.
Absolutely. And mobilization for youth became, as progressed, not just an organization that was trying to do something about delinquency. It wasn't an anti-delinquency program, but it became an anti-poverty program, a major, major shift that was largely accomplished because of Dick's influence. And as you say, moving more towards, and I must admit, I'd like to bring your own background into this as you experience the opportunity yourself at Bridgewater. Wasn't that the case too? So it's ironic that this offered you, your undergraduate education offered you such an opportunity to see a much more diverse and world. And here you then move on to a sociologist, criminologist whose major work is on opportunity. Correct?
I would actually trace my biography a bit earlier to St. Gregory's Elementary School in the Dorchester area neighborhood in Boston. Okay. And I was virtually an all Irish Catholic school. And then I followed my older brother and my father before him to Boston English High School, which was an inner city public school. We were always threatened as kids that if we messed up, they would send us to public school. So mm-hmm. I chose to go to public school voluntarily, one of the few kids in my class to do so. But that's the first experience I had with kids from all over Boston, of all races, ethnicities. I'd never experienced anything like that. And it quickly became obvious to me that I had certain opportunities that other people might not have had. And I think that's probably why I developed a social science orientation, or a view that how context and opportunity matters. And going to Bridgewater was another experience which drew kids from the Fall River and New Bedford area of Massachusetts, and not a lot of working class kids. And I just think that my educational experiences sensitized me to really just the diverse challenges that so many people growing up in Massachusetts faced, that I never would have been aware of if I had just stayed in a limited, say, Catholic education all the way through. And that, again, that's what drew me to Columbia, was to study urban education. And then what drew me to Dick was his passion for both ideas and also to change society for the better. I feel like there was almost an immediate bond between us, because his view of sociology and his view of the world so much coincided with my own. I feel like I was just fortunate that I was prepared to walk into his office and find a mentor who, if I had walked into 50 other offices, I never would have had. And well, so that coincidental relationship, you know, completely transformed my academic trajectory in life.
Yeah. Now you're also, as you have said, very much rooted in an evidence-based criminology and concerned with empirical data and so on. How did Dick respond to that concern? And before you answer that, let me just bring this up. I don't know if you were talking about going to different offices. This was on the office door of Richard Cloward. And for those of you who can't see it, Robin Hood was right. Mr. Cloward, everybody can see that? Robin Hood was right. So this is the office that you entered into. And here's another picture of Dick on the picket line. The rich are eating everything. So the rich are eating everything. So this is the world and office you were walking into as the Catholic American, the Catholic Boston City kid. But also now you're being introduced to some pretty radical stuff. So how did Dick respond to the issues of empiricism and evidence-based criminology?
I'm going to answer that in two ways. The first one is that he didn't do quantitative studies. He wrote books that shaped the field.
Yes. Yeah.
And what he told me was, and I won't use the exact language he used, but he said, "Frank, let all those other people do those crappy little empirical studies, and you make sense of them." I am a theorist, and I do try to make sense out of those crappy little empirical studies, although I didn't use the word crappy. And so, but it was a sense of that there are sort of two kinds of scholars, those that are sort of mired in the data and very narrow, and those that try to, if they can, take those ideas and think more broadly, right, to influence more people through his thinking. So I think in a lot of ways, he was never antagonistic to empirical studies. Mm-hmm, he was never, you know, he obviously, you know, would integrate evidence into his books to make a highly compelling case. So he was evidence-based in that sense. But I think his way of scholarship, which is not really very often done today, was even as a graduate student, don't just think narrow, think larger, think what the broader point is. Think about how you can have ideas that can shape other people's thinking, be an influencer, so to speak. So I think that was the effect that he had on me, was not to narrow me or make me write, do advanced quantitative studies, but rather to be somebody who could see the big picture.
Yeah.
And being around him, I got to see him do that. And I'm not a Dick Cloward, but I am somebody in his tradition in that sense of trying to think beyond the studies to what the bigger points are. And so I think that was an enduring effect he had on me.
Absolutely. And as a public intellectual and as an activist, the influence of C. Wright Mills at the time, also at Columbia, a little earlier than Dick, and the debate about so-called grand theory and abstract empiricism and the concerns more for middle range theory. How would you typify Dick's attitude of that influence at Columbia?
I think what the way I would put it is this way, is that what was important to Dick was that ideas should matter, right? He wasn't just doing ideas, for broad, pure science ideas. Now, if you take Robert Merton, who I also had in class and had great admiration for, he was more of a pure scientist. Some of his works had applicability, but that was not the thrust of his career. For Dick, he studied ideas so that they could then make a difference in the world. And I think that's what I took from him. I wanted to study ideas in my own field that would eventually shape policy and could affect the real world. And I think, middle range ideas are ideas that are understandable to people, that are not overly esoteric. For those of my generation who had to read Talcott Parsons's work, which was impenetrable, which is one of the things that C. Wright Mills showed in Sociological Imagination. It was not studying theory just to be a theorist, but studying ideas that would then have an ability to have an impact in the public policy area. And so I definitely drew on Richard's background in that area, and that had a defining influence on me. It's hard not to, when he's somebody who, by the time I met him, had already done mobilization for youth, was writing Regulating the Poor, was involved in expanding poor people's movements, voting, and all of that stuff. My criminology was aside from that, but the larger lesson, I think, was apparent.
He could also be very tough. I mean, I remember in class he would say, he would try to tone it down a bit with some of the students. He said, I'm naturally combative in my interaction with you. But he didn't, he was open, he was gentle also, and in guiding students, as you're pointing out too, he was with me too, to give us sort of more of a leeway to explore what was going on in our minds too, to go outside the box. But he could stand up. I mean, Merton was his mentor, yet there was a falling out and he stood up to Merton. I don't know if you are familiar with that story, but Merton wanted to, as I understand it, use Cloward's theory to further support his, to gain admiration among the left. And Cloward said, I'm not going to do that. I don't know if you're aware of that, but of that story. And they didn't speak to each other for years. So the point is, Cloward was such a man of such moral integrity and openness too, but you don't cross him, the viewpoints that he's trying to extol and put forward.
I would say that my experiences with him were almost uniformly positive, because I didn't dare pass anything into him that wasn't perfect, or at least as perfect as I could make it. I remember one time he was reading my dissertation. When I was at his home in Millerton, New York, he had a home with Francis. And he went upstairs and he came down and he said, this is pretty good. After reading some of my chapters, I was so relieved. I was like sat there for a couple hours as he was reading my stuff saying, well, I hope I didn't mess this up. And he came down and, he was always generous to me. But I think the thing that I also remember about him is his loyalty. I always knew that as a student, he was such a decent person that he would protect me and have my back. At Columbia, you sort of either got a mentor or you didn't. And if you didn't get a mentor, you might not make it through. I always knew that he would guide me through that. The other thing was, is that he asked me to work with him. And I have now worked with 33 graduate students, and I have followed his role in that, that almost all of them, I invite them to work with me. I don't just wait for them to ask me. And his invitation to me meant so much to me personally at the time, that I felt at that moment, my graduate career had a future, and that I had somebody I could count on, a decent person. But on the other hand, I would not have dared not to do as good work as possible, or I know that it would have been a less pleasant situation. But my experiences with him were uniformly positive.
I concur. If you got his approval, it meant everything in the world, and you had to work for it. But when it happened, it was, can't get any better than that. I wonder how Dick's influence for you can be brought into some of your own writings and work, and particularly perhaps in a more contemporary sense, as we all as criminologists are trying to deal with the enormous questioning of the criminal justice system, Black Lives Matter and police brutality and so on. It would be so wonderful to have Dick here in this discussion, but we'll do the best we can. So how are you relating to the incredible turmoil in the field? What are you able to get and bring back from that experience with Dick that stands you in good stead now in your work?
Well, I think it was one of his key insights were that there are only certain times when change is possible. You may struggle for change all the time, but it's not always happening. Like, you know, you may struggle to get poor people the right, you know, register them to vote. And some people would say, yeah, well, you might get a backlash from that. But he said, no, you have to like struggle all the time and look for those moments when change is possible. And I think that that's what he would be seeing today. What people are waking up to are the different injustices, and they're willing to listen, and they're willing to pursue policy changes. And I think he would see this as one of those rare historical moments where real change is possible. You know, and I think one of the areas is in the area of mass imprisonment, which is more what I study, corrections. Mm-hmm. You know, for almost my entire academic life, I assumed that the prison population was going to keep increasing my entire life. And then after 39 years in 2009, it stopped. And now it's come down a couple hundred thousand people, not great, but not continuing to rise. And the rhetoric around getting tough is dissipating. The opportunities for reentry programs, for rehabilitation programs, restorative justice, and many other things, which were not possible 10 years ago, are possible now. The House of Representatives just voted to reinstitute Pell Grants for prison inmates so they could get funding to have higher education, which was eliminated to hurt inmates 20 or so years ago. I think we're at a moment where all sorts of change is possible within law enforcement, within corrections, particularly in reducing prison populations. So I think if he were here today, he would be asking the question, what can we do to capitalize on this historical moment, to mobilize poor people, rich people, people of good hearts, to do something to affect changes that were not possible even 10 years ago? And so that's sort of the lesson I took from him, is that we can make a difference, even though most of the time we're not successful. There are those moments, and I think this is one of those historic moments where change, at least some change, is on the horizon.
But I think, as Dick would point out too, there's the possibility of intense backlash to that. And we see that, of course, in the form of Trump and others. I mean, there's just an article in the Times today about blaming the higher rates of homicide in New York City on early release programs and things like that. So this dies hard because, right, aren't we so rooted in the idea of the criminal, the deviant, as someone who is immoral, unethical, less than human, possessed by the devil, the penitentiary, we need the penitentiary for them to be penitent. You need to teach them a lesson. So the struggles are intense, right?
Well, I would agree with you and then have one bit of disagreement. I agree with you that he would be, Richard would be immensely aware of the fact of the power structures and how many attempts to do good are going to get derailed, right? And that ultimately is going to take political solutions to this, voting people out of office, electing progressives, and things of that sort. On the other hand, one of the things I've spent my career on is studying public attitudes about offenders and rehabilitation. And in fact, the American public, they're punitive, but they also believe in rehabilitation. I just did studies on, does the American public believe in the redeemability of offenders, that they can change? And high percentages, like 80% of the American public, believes in the changeability of offenders, the malleability, their ability to become reformed again. We actually asked specific questions about African-American offenders and got almost the exact same results. So I think the heart of America is a lot kinder than people realize. What I think has happened in the past is that politicians have played to the darker side of American beliefs, accentuated those and used those. But in fact, the American public is prepared for a range of policies that would be, they don't like prisons, they're not in favor of mass imprisonment. Almost everybody supports reentry services, to people coming back into society. Almost everybody supports juvenile rehabilitation. And so I think that there's actually much more goodness in the American people and their beliefs that have not been capitalized upon, but progressive politicians that I think can do so and wouldn't be getting elected if that general sentiment that it wasn't there. So I'm a little bit more optimistic on that regard, while also understanding the barriers to reforms of any sort.
Where do you stand on the abolition movement? I had an activist on a couple of weeks ago, I guess, Eight to Abolition. She co-founded that movement. We've had Alex Vitale, I don't know if you know him, from Brooklyn College, talking about defunding the police. Do you think we're ready to go further than just rehabbing or reforming the system? What about abolition? Where do you stand on that?
Well, if you ask me how I stand on it utopian-wise, I would be certainly sympathetic to that. I teach in a criminal justice program. We have a lot of people work, you have connections with people in the system. I think that the that abolition is a goal, but it's not, it doesn't provide the concrete practical means of how right now we get the system to be less punitive. To me, I think we should focus on what kinds of strategies can we use to get as many people out of prison as we can without saying we want to abolish prisons. Now, if we're having a conversation among friends, I would be sympathetic to that. But having a conversation with policymakers, a discussion on abolition out here in the Midwest, not the East Coast, is going to shut down the conversation immediately. So I think we have to give them good reasons for why use of prisons is not a good idea. And we just finished a study where we reviewed all the studies that have been done looking at what is the effect of putting somebody in prison versus putting them in the community. And we found that the effect on deterring offenders, of putting somebody in prison, is zero. No. If anything, it makes people more criminal if you send them to prison. It was just a huge study on 112,000 offenders published in Nature by a group of researchers showing exactly the same thing. Prisons do not deter. They do not stop people from offending, except for the time when they're in prison and incapacitated. The effect of prison on future behavior is completely ineffective. That's the kind of information I'm interested in sharing and of trying to persuade as many people as possible about the irrationality of prisons. But then we have to give them the concrete means of what do we do not to send people to prison. And I think if we do that, then I think the inclination to incarcerate is going to go down. I actually am quite optimistic that prison populations are going to start to decline in the years ahead. One of the reasons is that the cohort behind the current older cohort in prison, I have heard, is actually a lower crime cohort. They're not serving as long sentences. So demographically, right, once the older population has gotten these 25-year sentences, yeah, or 15-year sentences,
being let off,
age out of the system, the next cohort is not going to, they're not going to serve as long. We're going to see a reduction in prison populations.
Right.
So again, I don't mean to go on you forever, but the main point I would say is that, you know, I am for whatever practical means we can use in any local community to find ways to keep people in the community, to treat them in the community, to reintegrate them in the community, and to give politicians and policymakers the means not to incarcerate. I think if we do that over a long term period, that our use of incarceration is going to go down a great deal.
Is this a little bit what you're trying to do when you talk about the social support theory of crime that you've been involved in?
Yeah, that was I think the problem with many theories of crime is they look at what's wrong with society, what's wrong with people, about why they went to crime. I was interested in the other side of the coin, which is if we give people social support, whether it's welfare, safety nets, programs to assist families, whatever. Would that actually lead to less crime? And the evidence is pretty persuasive that it does. So I think, you know, we need to give, not just show what's wrong with people or what's wrong with society, but to give, I think, perspectives that show what to do, what positive steps we can take to try to insulate people from crime or to get them out of the crime. I found that the social support idea, which I first wrote in 1994, it's more popular today than it was back then. And I think that relates to the prevailing social context where people are looking for ways to do positive things with offenders in society. So it is something that I'm planning on writing a book on, but that'll have to wait about a year for that to get done.
Right.
So that, thank you for the ability to advertise that.
Yeah. And are you possibly circling back to some of those positive experiences maybe you had in Catholic school there? And you're raising the possibility of a transformative justice system that is talking about radical love and learning from the other and appreciating that and connecting to people like Cornel West and Reverend William Barber, Poor People's Campaign. Is that part of it as well?
Well, my work in corrections has recently focused on redemption. And what I mean by that is, it's one thing to tell an offender to become rehabilitated, but they're never going to be accepted back into society unless we accept them back, unless we're willing to offer redemption. So many offenders who come out of prison suffer from a criminal record, they can't get jobs, they suffer from collateral consequences. And what I'm interested in are things like rehabilitation ceremonies, things which will wipe their slate clean, expungement, but more than that, an active process where we start to build into corrections the idea that we need to offer people redemption. Like if people come out and if they try rehabilitation and they stay out of crime, we cannot burden them the rest of their life with the stigma of a criminal sanction. We cannot burden them the rest of their life with rejection and exclusion and collateral consequences. We need to take active strides to reintegrate them into society. And that's our responsibility to do that, not their responsibility. If all we do is have them finish a rehabilitation program and then we don't do anything to reward that, to accept that, to redeem them publicly and make a proclamation that these folks are now among the citizenry again, then I think that stymies how effective the correctional system can be. So that's like another research agenda I have is looking at how we as citizens can act in a redemptive way towards offenders.
Another term be restorative justice? Would that be getting at?
Yes, I think that would be something that would
healing.
Would be subsumed. Yes, no, absolutely. We have to find ways to restore people, to heal them, to accept them, to make them feel as though they're valued, because there's absolutely no social science evidence that treating people in a punitive, stigmatizing way does anything but make the problem worse. We certainly wouldn't treat any family member that way. And so in a lot of ways, I agree with you that all of these interventions that emphasize restoration, reintegration, redemption, that is really where I think the future of corrections lies. And how do we build that into the fabric of the system? As we move away from this punitive model, how do we create a corrections that's humane, socially just, accepting, and I would add, evidence-based and effective?
Well, I think Dick would be so happy with us in this show. We have roots in Catholicism, minor partly in Judaism, and we've learned both from the son of a radical Baptist minister. And that may tell us something. I don't know what it tells us, but I have enjoyed this so much, Frank. I think I told you maybe before the show, one of the first books that Dick had me look at was your thesis, your dissertation. I thank you so very much. It was great. It was wonderful. It was so helpful. And I've just thoroughly enjoyed this show and finally meeting you. And I hope we continue on with our relationship here and perhaps writing and hearing more about what you've been writing yourself.
I welcome our friendship, our emerging friendship here today. And I feel a bond with you like I did with Dick. And being able to go back and think about him, to relive his influence in my life is so warming and brought back great memories that I think I will have for many years to come. So I appreciate the opportunity to share our common bond with Dick in a way that I really couldn't have done with anybody else. So
Thank you, it's been
a privilege to do this. Thank you very much.
Thank you so very much. And thank you so very much to all of you who have been watching our show. This is Jim Vrettos, and we're going to be seeing you again next week on The Radical Imagination. Take care.
You know, when Diana Ross and the Supremes were on our show not long ago, they introduced their number Love Child, which rocketed overnight to number one in the charts. Now here, singing that big hit again, Diana Ross and the Supremes. Diana Ross and the Supremes were on our show not long ago. They introduced their number Love Child, which rocketed overnight to number one in the charts. Now here, singing that big hit again, Diana Ross and the Supremes. You know, when Diana Ross and the Supremes were on our show not long ago, they introduced their number Love Child, which rocketed overnight to number one in the charts. Now here, singing that big hit again, Diana Ross and the Supremes.
Little bit slow. love. What I feel for you is real love.